Good evening, dear Philippe Sands, dear Sofia Dyak, dear Marina Chernivsky, dear guests and friends of the Jewish Museum Berlin. I'm Hetty Berg, the director of the Jewish Museum Berlin, and I would like to welcome you very warmly to this fifth evening in the event series, Ukraine in Context, Jewish Perspectives on Ukraine, Present and Past. With this series, the Jewish Museum Berlin, together with the German Federal Agency for Civic Education and OFEK, aim to make Jewish perspectives on the Russian war of aggression against Ukraine audible and visual, and provide insights into the complexities of present-day Ukraine in its historical context. And we are very grateful for this extraordinary fruitful cooperation with the German Federal Agency for Civic Education and OFEK, and with our partners that are both sitting here on the stage. We have structured the series around the Jewish experience in major Ukrainian cities in order to explore the many different spheres of influence, beginning with Kharkiv and Chernivtsi, and stopping in Odessa and Dnipro along the way. Today we turn towards the many-layered political history of Lviv or Lemberg in Galicia in western Ukraine. I'm delighted to welcome our speakers tonight, the British expert in international law, Philippe Sands, here with us from London. We are very happy and honored to welcome you to the Jewish Museum Berlin. And here from the city of Lviv is the Ukrainian historian Sofia Dyak. Thank you very much for making the long journey and that you can be with us here in Berlin. It's great. Our cooperation partner and psychologist, Marina Chernivsky, is the third on our podium today with her personal view on memory culture in Lviv. They will talk about the Jewish history of Lviv, the politics of memory in the Soviet Union and in Ukraine, and about international law and crimes against humanity, including in the context of Russia's current war of aggression. Let me tell you a little bit more about our speakers. Philippe Sands is Professor of Law at University College London and Visiting Professor of Law at Harvard. He's a practicing barrister at 11 KBW, appears as counsel before the International Court of Justice and other international courts and tribunals, and sits as an international arbitrator. He's a board member of Hay Festival and president of English Pen. His latest books are The Red Line, Love, Lies and Justice on the Trail of a Nazi Fugitive, 2020, and The Last Colony, A Tale of Exile, Justice and Britain's Colonial Legacy, 2022. His wonderful book on his journey back to Lviv is the point of departure of this evening. East-West Street, on the Origins of Crimes Against Humanity and Genocide of 2016. Sofia Dyak is a Lviv-based historian who studies urban post-war transformations and recoveries, especially in post-displacement cities, as well as the role of heritage practices and concepts in socialist contexts. Since 2010, she has been a director of the Center for Urban History in Lviv. Among other major achievements, she was a fellow at the Historical Dialogue and Accountability Program at Columbia University and the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute. And most recently, a senior research fellow at the research project Legacies of Communism, led by the Center for Contemporary History in Potsdam. Another area of her work is public history, including curating exhibitions and spatial commemorative projects. Marina Chernivsky is a psychologist, head of the Competence Center for Prevention and Empowerment, as well as the founder and director of OFEK, an NGO supporting victims of anti-Semitic violence and discrimination. Born in Lviv, she was raised in Israel and came to Germany as a student. In her various positions, she deals with questions of memory culture in Eastern Europe, as well as the psychosocial consequences of trauma and war. The moderators of this evening, also on the podium, are our cooperation partner from the German Federal Agency for Civic Education, Kateryna Stetsevych, originally from Chernivtsi, and Daniel Wildmann, program director of the W. Michael Blumenthal Academy of the Jewish Museum Berlin, where we are here now. I would like to thank both Kateryna Stetsevych and Marina Chernivsky for conceiving of this event series together with Senior Rosbach of the Michael Blumenthal Academy. And many thanks go to Eva Maria Helfrich from the events department of the JMB for organizing this evening, as well as the tech team from ArtLights. And I would like to take the occasion to thank our translators tonight, Kateryna Ritz-Rakul, Olena Bikovic, Brigitte Weber, and Susanne Konczak. In the booth. But now, enough of all these introductions, I'm happy to give the word over to you, Kateryna and Daniel, for our journey to Lviv. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hetty, and good evening, everybody. My name is Daniel Wildmann, as Hetty explained to you, and I'm going to chair tonight's panel together with Kateryna Stetsevych over there. How do we run this panel tonight? We firstly will have a discussion among us here on stage, probably for about 60 minutes, and then open the panel for questions from your side. Now, how do we do the discussion? We decided to split our panel on Lviv, content-wise, into two parts. A first part about what we call place and relations, which means focusing on questions about belonging to Lviv, stories of leaving Lviv, and stories of returning to Lviv. The second part would be about justice and tribunal, a short title which seems to be self-explanatory, but we see about that later. We also thought it might be a good idea to start our panel with short, 5 minutes statements from our panelists here, short statements. So let's start with Philippe Sands and a reading from his absolutely extraordinary book, East, West Street. You really have to read it. You can also buy it later over there. A book about his family history and about the origins of international law at the Nuremberg trial. Philippe, over to you.
Thank you very much to the Jewish Museum for the invitation and to the organizers for putting together this panel. It's special for me to be in Berlin, and it's special for me to be in Berlin talking about Lemberg, Lviv, Lvov, Lvov, Leopolis. It's all the same place, although I didn't know that when I first got an invitation. So I just thought I would go back to the beginning, my relationship with this city. I left London for Lviv in late October. I traveled with my mother, skeptical, anxious, my widowed aunt Annie, who had been married to my mother's brother, calm, and my 15-year-old son, curious. In Vienna, we boarded a smaller plane for the 650-kilometer trip east, across the invisible line that once marked the Iron Curtain. To the north of Budapest, the plane descended over the Ukrainian spa town of Truskavets through a cloudless sky so we could see the Carpathian Mountains and, in the distance, Romania. The landscape around Lviv, the bloodlands described by one historian in his book on the terrors visited upon the area by Stalin and Hitler, was flat, wooded, and agricultural, a scattering of fields pockmarked with villages and small holdings, human habitations in red, brown, and white. We must have passed directly over the small town of Zhovkva as Lviv came into sight, a distant sprawl of an ex-Soviet metropolis, and then the center of the city, the spires and domes that jumped out of the undulating greenery one after another, the towers of places I would come to know, of St. George's, St. Elizabeth's, the town hall, the cathedral, the Corniac and the Bernardine that were so dear to the poet Joseph Vitlin's heart. I saw, without knowing them, the cupolas of the Dominican Church, the City Theatre, the Union of Lublin Mound, and the bald, sandy Piakoskva Hill, which soaked up the blood of thousands of martyrs during the German occupation. I would grow familiar with all these places. The plane taxied to a stop before a low building. It would not have been out of place in a Tintin book, as though we were back in 1923, when the airport enjoyed the evocative name of Skinliviv. There was a familial symmetry. The city's imperial railway station opened in 1904, the year of my grandfather Leon's birth. The Skniliv air terminal opened in 1923, the year of his departure. The new air terminal emerged in 2010, the year in which his descendants first returned. The old terminal hadn't changed much in the intervening century, with its marbled hall and large wooden doors and the officious, fresh-faced guards dressed in green, a bit like the Wizard of Oz, barking orders without authority. We, the passengers, stood about in a long line that snaked towards a patch of wooden cubicles occupied by grim immigration officers, each wearing a giant, ill-fitting green cap. "Why here?" the officer asked. "Lecture," I replied. He stared at me blankly. Then he repeated the word, not once, but three times. "Lecture, lecture, lecture." "University, university, university," I responded, which prompted a grin, a stamp, and a right of entry. We wandered through customs past many dark-haired men wearing shiny black leather coats, all of them smoking. In a taxi, we headed to the old center, passing dilapidated 19th century buildings in the style of Vienna, and then the great Ukrainian Catholic Cathedral of St. George, past the old Galician Parliament, into the main thoroughfare, bookended by the Opera House and an impressive monument to the poet Adam Mickiewicz. Our hotel was close to the medieval center on Teatralna Street, called Rutowskiego by the Poles and Langegasse by the Germans. To follow the names and maintain a sense of historical bearing, I took to wandering around the streets with three maps: a modern Ukrainian map published in 2010, an old Polish map published in 1930, and a more ancient Austrian map published in 1911. On our first evening, we searched for Leon's house, my grandfather. I had an address from his birth certificate, an English translation prepared in 1938 by one Bolesław Czuruk of Lwów. With his translation, Professor Czuruk told me that Leon was born at number 12 Szeptyczki Street and that he was delivered into the world by the midwife Matilda Agid. Today, Szeptyczki Street is known as, I'm not going to even try to pronounce this, Szeptyczki Street, close to St. George's Cathedral. To walk there, we circled Rynok Square, admired 15th century merchants' houses, passed City Hall and the Jesuit Cathedral, which was shuttered during the Soviet era and used as an archive and book depository, and then into a nondescript square in front of St. George's Cathedral, which was where the Nazi governor of Galicia, Dr. Otto von Wächter, recruited members of the Waffen-SS Galicia division in 1943. From this square, it was but a short walk to Szeptycki Street, named in honor of Andrei Szeptycki, the renowned Metropolitan Archbishop of the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church, who, in November 1942, published a pastoral letter titled, "Thou Shalt Not Murder." Number 12 was a two-story late 19th century building with five large windows on the first floor next to a building with a large Star of David spray-painted onto a wall. From the city archives, I would obtain a copy of the construction plans and the early permits. I learned that the building was constructed in 1878, that it was divided into six flats, that there were four shared toilets, and that there was an inn on the floor, and it may have been the one run by Leon's father, Pinchas Buchholz, although a 1913 city directory listed him as the proprietor of a restaurant a few buildings up at number 18. We entered the building. On the first floor, an elderly man answered our knock, Yevgen Timshin, born there, he told us, in 1943 during German rule. The Jews had gone, he added. The apartment was empty. Inviting us in, his friendly but somewhat shy wife proudly showed us around the extended single room that was the couple's home. We drank black tea, admired pictures on the wall, and talked of the challenges of modern Ukraine. Behind the tiny kitchen at the back of the house was a small balcony where Yevgen and I stood. He put on an old military cap. Yevgen and I smiled, the sun shone, St. George's Cathedral loomed as it had in 1904 in May.
Yeah, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. On this very symbolic day, I think it is an honor to speak about returning to the history, and it is very important to speak about the history and to overthink the present days. Dear Sofia, we entered a landscape of Lviv, a landscape which is full of legends of myths and at the same time full of reality. Maybe you could give us a very short insight into the history of the city of Lviv as a historian and as a native of this city.
It's working. Thank you for the invitation. And I would not dare to tell you the whole history or part of that. It's not the whole, really, but it's really my big pleasure to be here, and thank you for the invitation. And today's conversation for me is a mixture and of professional. I was introduced as a historian, but also personal. I was born and raised in Lviv, and I keep living there and working there. And as Philippe said, the city has many names written in several alphabets. And for me, one way to see the city is as a place of connection, actually as any place one could see. Throughout its history, both rich and troubled, the city of Lviv has been a place of coming and going. As a hub of economic exchange and social migration on the crossroads of Eastern Europe, it was a site to live in, but also to leave. Over the course of history, reasons for leaving the cities were many, from looking for a job, a better place to live, to escaping oppression. And throughout the 20th century, the city really changed its territorial alliances and belongings and being part of 8 times. The decisions to leave the city became more often connected with violence, flight, expulsion, deportation, ethnic cleansing, and death and murder on an witnessed scale. Not literally one life in the city was left untouched by the violence of Europe's 20th century. So the city had more of 90% of its buildings left undestroyed as a result of the Second World War, but more than 90% of its inhabitants were killed or displaced or deported. So Lviv's street do offer a possibility to enter history, but entering the buildings, as Philippe did, and by asking simple yet difficult questions. Who lived here? Where did they study and work? Which places did they leave to, or from which places were they forced to leave? And where might their paths within the city have ended? Asking these questions is a way of opening ruptures and weaving connections. On September 10th, 2010, I received an email from Philippe Sands about meeting in Lviv later in October that year. In his email, Philippe wrote, let me quote, "For my part, I hope this first visit might evolve into a longer connection," unquote. For Philippe, one of such connections was that it was a place of his grandfather's birth, but that was just the beginning. Neither of us expected how many connections would emerge from this first visit. Back then, in the autumn of 2010, I was intensely thinking about the last war, which now we call previous. We were working with the city council and Jewish organizations in Lviv and with the Lviv office of German GIZ on the initiatives to mark three sites of Jewish history in Lviv. And one of them was the site of three destroyed buildings in the city center, two synagogues and a Beit HaMidrash. In 2016, one of them was opened as a memorial site, the space of synagogues, designed by Berlin-based architect Franz Reschke. Part of its installation was 21 quotations from memoirs and diaries, and one of them came from your work, but this is not the one I will quote. One was, I will quote, came from Janina Heschelis Altman. She was born in Lviv in 1931. Then she was residing in Haifa in Israel in that year. She survived the Holocaust as a teenage girl. Her father, Henrik, a journalist and editor of a major Jewish newspaper in Lviv, was killed in the first pogrom on June 30th of 1941. Many decades later, she reluctantly came to Lviv. Her words became one of the quotes. Quoting, "Lviv is everywhere. It speaks to everyone who has been forced from their village or town, everyone who lost their family in violent circumstances." In 2016, these words resonated poignantly with the experiences of internally displaced citizens of Ukraine who were forced to leave their homes in the regions annexed and occupied by the Russian Federation in 2014. In no way could we foresee how resonant they would become later, last year, as refugees were fleeing the horrors of the war. As of March last year, 50,000 people were passing Lviv daily, and probably some of them have to live here. So what words can we use to capture this relation between specific places and people coming from different ethnic groups considering this place as part of their ancestor homelands? How does this change the ways we see the place we live now, the history and culture of Ukraine, the ways the world is related through such stories? On February 24, 2022, I received an email from LA from a man who visited Lviv in 2018, carrying with him a copy of East-West Street, and he was going on to Odessa. a place of his Jewish ancestors for the first time. On that day in the morning, he wrote, "What, quote, what a nightmare. I can't believe this is happening to my beloved Ukraine," unquote. His beloved Ukraine. In 2018, he was not thinking. It was Odessa and not Ukraine. So now it's time to connect our questions about the past to our visions of the future. Maybe such global communities of places open new spaces of belonging and possibilities for justice and solidarity. Learning to acknowledge our responsibility for the implications of the past in the places we inhabit, we can, as individuals and as societies, acquire a better understanding of the origins of violence and injustice, and maybe forge that understanding into thinking of and acting for a better, less violent, and more just future, even or especially when we are in the midst of the war.
Dear Sofia, thank you very much for these insights and your statement. We will talk about the future a little bit later. And now I have a question to Marina. Marina, we are talking about the places and about the relationship to this place and about the returning. And you returned to Lviv again and again after you left the city in the late 80s. Am I right? Yeah, thank you. And what does it mean to you to return to the city of your childhood?
You know, I have prepared also a short statement because it's the first time sitting in Jewish Museum of Berlin and talking English, but it was the decision of Daniel.
And Marina, you are not alone.
And your question is a little bit too früh, because I have a statement and I must read it. It's okay? Because I have also some pictures. And I sent an email on Sofia to Sofia 2012. And I was also on this road. So, and it was very important meeting. And I'm very happy to talk to you and with you today. And the book of Philippe was a very important milestone in my relationship to Lviv and my own history. And I know some people in this room also and very thankful for this book. So once I lived in a city that fascinated me. I could only guess what was hidden behind the old facades. I knew that the stories of people were repressed and overwritten. But there were a few who wondered who once lived in this place. But doesn't every city has its own history? Certainly, it's true for all cities in the world. Nevertheless, Lviv is special. Individual and collective pasts meet each other in a unique way. The boss, world wars, the shifting borders, terror, the persecutions, death, left very deep traces in the soul of this place. Lviv, Lvov, Lemberg, many names for different people and different meaning. However, not only the negative history, but also the action and living and life of former residents of the city made this place kind of magical. Lviv was also a kind of shelter for Jewish people and Jewish, Polish, and Ukrainian culture. People living in the city spoke Polish, Yiddish, Ukrainian, German, Armenian, Ivrit. Soviet rule and later, 2 years later, also German occupation destroyed this rich tradition at all. This unbelievable legacy of Lviv was kept private, only as a part of family stories, at least. This legacy didn't find a proper place in the collective memory. The historical splendor of Lviv survived the war, but the people were gone, you said it. After the war, their homes were occupied by newcomers, the streets were given new names, the furniture and silverware, photo albums and books that once belonged to people were still in their place, but without their owners. Almost the entire pre-war population of Lviv was replaced. After the war, only a few remained alive or returned to Lviv. It was impossible to get back to the time before. The destruction was all-embracing. Something new was born there. Exactly 10 years ago, I set out to explore the lost stories of this city. With a film crew, I started to meet people who were committed to this place and who explored the city with me. The film has not been released yet. The city spoke to me and we were in relationship again. Walls and stones show the past. Everywhere in the city I saw stones. They were used for road construction during and after the war. Ukrainian took them, the stones, to the Jewish cemetery or Jewish hospital. The Jewish community was looking for support. On this journey, I met many people who felt this past with me. One of them, the stones, the artist Victoria Kowalczuk, unfortunately she died a few years ago, compared the old magnificent facades to the skin of the city. She found Jewish places which became invisible over the years. She created images giving these places back their meanings. In Germany, the society seems to be convicted to know a lot about the Shoah. Deceptive knowledge, I would argue, a deceptive knowledge that established the legend about a masterful coming to the terms with the past. However, today, we live in a society that accepts the crime, but continues in the same time to deny direct personal connection to that. In Lviv, it was different. There was no state effort to preserve the knowledge. The state erased the memory. In recent years, in the independent Ukraine, many people and initiatives are trying to fill these gaps. Today, Lviv is once again a place of memory and also a place of escape for so many refugees in this current war. Jewish community, together with many others, support them. The transhistorical trauma, the split memory, grows together a bit. The connection to the past is a source of strange for me. At least, but I know for many people there, and also emerging for our future. Thank you. It wasn't your question, I'm sorry. It was a little bit.
Thank you, Marina. As we can see from these three statements, our panelists, they do represent three very different positions or forms of relations to Lviv. Sofia stays in Lviv, you live there in Lviv. Marina has left Lviv and is kind of coming back. And Philippe has come back, but without having been there before, right? So, Philippe, could you elaborate a bit about coming back without having been there before? You know, when you traveled to Lviv first time in your life, 2010, giving a lecture about crimes against humanity, about genocide, about the two men who put these crimes into the Nuremberg trial, Herr Schlauterbach and Raphael Lemkin, something very remarkable happened. A young student took the liberty to ask you to research your family history, your grandfather, Leo Buchholz from Lviv, because he is, as she put it, the closest to your heart.
So it's very interesting listening to Marina and Sofia, because obviously we do have different relationships to this place. I received this invitation out of the blue, spring of 2010. Would I care to come and give a lecture about the cases that I do on crimes against humanity and genocide? The invitation came from a place I'm ashamed to say I had never really heard of. Lviv, what's Lviv? And I looked it up on the map, and Lviv was Lemberg. And my grandfather was born in Lemberg, and I thought, huh, that's really interesting. I don't actually really want to give a lecture, but I'd really like to find the house where he was born. That would be important for me, because to understand where my grandfather was born would tell me more about his identity and more about my identity. My grandfather never once talked about Lemberg. He never, ever talked about anything that happened before 1945. And I knew him for a long time. I knew him for 37 years. He lived until 1997. So, you know, it was very striking. My brother and I knew things had happened, but we grew up in a household of complete silence about what precisely had happened. So I thought, yeah, that'd be really great to go. And one thing, a lot of people say to me, oh, it must have been really difficult and painful and everything. But you forget, you mustn't forget, my day job is dealing with mass murder. So I'm pretty hardened to some of the things that I come to see. And to go back to this place, of course, had many levels of complexity, but I've created mechanisms of protection that allow me to go into these places with a pretty open and robust mind. What I had not expected, of course, was that this place, which was part of my DNA, also happened to be the place where the origins of these two 1945 crimes, genocide, the protection of groups, crimes against humanity, the protection of individuals, were actually invented. The two men who put these two crimes into international law in 1945 had both studied at the University of Lviv, and the people who invited me did not know that fact. I didn't know that fact. I came across it by accident. I can claim no great brilliance or anything for having found it. It was a total accident, and of course that makes me and others ask the question, how could it be that such a thing could happen? I don't think it's complete coincidence. I think we have other forms of communicating and other forms in which things happen. So I arrived in a place, knowing already that this was the hometown of Lauterpacht, of Lemkin, and of my grandfather Leon, which meant it was a place to me of extraordinary fascination. Just out of curiosity, who here has been to Lviv? Okay, so not that many. I mean, quite a few. I mean, it is the most extraordinary place. It's a place where when you walk in the streets, you can imagine yourself back in the 1890s or the 1920s or the 1950s. It's a place which utterly opens the imagination. Everything is there in terms of the buildings, and so you're able to walk the street, as I did, armed with an extraordinary book by a Polish poet called Joseph Witlin, Mój Lwów, My Lviv, and the streets are completely unchanged. And that is incredibly rare. And so for me, it was a place of connection. It's an incredibly dark place. You'll walk down one street and you'll come to a place where large numbers of people were executed at a particular moment in time. And you don't know it at the time, but you learn it later. And once you've learned about it, or once you've seen some of the video films that were played at the Nuremberg trial and worked out where they are, Sophia and I have been over that, you look at the place in a different way. But what I have still some trouble understanding is why I'm so drawn to the place, why I feel so comfortable there. I absolutely love going there. I've been more than 20 times in the last 13 years. I was there in October out of solidarity in the moment of the war. There was a literary festival and I really wanted to go, and so it's a very long journey, as Sophia knows. But for me, what is in a sense slightly mysterious is this sense of connection. The moment I arrived, as Sophia knows, I felt completely at home. I felt comfortable there. I loved the food. I loved the buildings. I love the spaces, I love the darkness. And this is complex to understand what it is about it. But on the negative side, and I just want to put this right on the table, and I apologize to you, Sofia, in a sense for doing it, but it's part of this conversation. It's what is unsaid. You've both in your statements alluded to this. But I can best illustrate this with an experience that Sofia and I lived through in relation to the memorial which she has done so much to put in place at a establishment that used to be known as the Golden Rose Synagogue. And there are now a series of black marble stones inscribed, as Sofia explained, with the words of former residents. And Sofia very generously asked me to identify some words, and I did. And the words I was drawn to were the words of the niece of Hirsch Lauterpacht, the man who put the concept of crimes against humanity into international law. And she had described to me, when I interviewed her in about 2013, standing in the apartment where she lived with her parents, looking out of the window and seeing her mother being arrested. And I recorded the interview, so I've got it, and I've obviously checked it very carefully. And the form of words that she used were very precise. She said, "I saw my mother being rushed by Germans and Ukrainians." And so I took that sentence, a little bit longer bit of the sentence, and sent it to Sofia, and I said, I think those are the words that I think work for me, because I knew Inca and because it connected with a particular moment. And Sofia said, terrific, great, we'll go with that. And I think you were very comfortable with those words. But of course, we know what happened next. What happened next was that someone somewhere in the community or the municipality, you know more than I do, said, these words are not entirely excellent. Could we delete the words "and Ukrainians"? And this posed a really complex set of issues. I'm a believer in incrementalism, that less is more sometimes, and the best is the enemy of the good. So I could have adopted an absolutely sort of purist, no, those are the words Inka Katz used, we must use precisely her words. The compromise in the end was to remove the words Germans and Ukrainians. What you couldn't have was just leaving it with the Germans, because that's not what she said. What you could conceivably have is to leave out the identity of those who rushed. I've spent a lot of time thinking about this. This was not the last time this issue came up. Remarkably, when I gave the keynote at the Lviv Congress of PEN, the Writers Association Committed to Freedom of Expression, almost unbelievably, you couldn't imagine it, you couldn't invent it, I think. Sophia was as surprised and distressed as I was. The folks from PEN Ukraine also asked me to delete the words "and Ukrainian" from that quotation, which I refused to do and read out the words at the Congress and caused no difficulty at all. Everyone applauded wildly despite the words being in there. But the elephant in the room that I think one needs to talk about is how one deals with the past that shines a light on the community that now happens to be in control, which is a less than excellent or perfect light. And how does one move things along in that conversation?
We'll talk about the elephants in the room quite soon, but first, Kateryna, you continue.
Yeah, I have a question for Sofia. And I was listening to you, Philippe Sands, and you were talking about Lviv, and I remember our discussion, our start of the discussion about Chernivtsi, and we started it with the words, Chernivtsi exists really, and we can continue it with Lviv. Lemberg, Lviv exists really. But you were talking a lot, Marina, you also were talking about the returning to the city. Sofia, you have completely another setting. You live in this city, you is a historian, and you have another relationship. And I would say you have maybe another perspective on the city. And I wanted to ask you, how do you experience the other side when the people come to the city with very different aims for searching for their family history, for searching after the traces, who are looking for historic traces, who brings history back to this city. And this history, as we heard, is very complex and traumatic. How do you deal with it as an inhabitant of this city and as a historian living in Ukraine?
It's, you know, you don't have to leave a place to have a journey. You know, you can be in one place and have many, infinite number of journeys, which come with people who bring them. You know, and I'm privileged and honored to have this, you know, possibility, and I do cherish almost, I mean, each of them, because that's the meeting which opens the door, and you have a conversation. And as a historian, I do think that we, you know, especially in a city where you have such beautiful facade, what matters, people do matter, you know, and there are stories. And I think that this is really what drives me in my work, and also what helps me to be a citizen of a place where I live. I did learn a lot of things about the place. I learned a lot of things about myself through that. Many are very uncomfortable conversations, which, you know, you figure out how to be, you know, open and not on defensive. You have to talk back and have this conversation back and forward, you know. So this, because, you know, there is no one line, and at the end of the day, you know, we are humans relating to each other in this moment. And I think that we can have conversations, not always in the format which is would be the best, not always now, you know, or in the moment. And I think that what Philippe is, you know, this conversation about what do you include and what kind of, it requires a lot of patience, because we had the conversation, and just to give you a little bit of chronology, I'm a historian, so it kind of comes with the dates. So the conversation we had in 2013, and then there were around 100 quotes for this memorial, and the Jewish community representatives, we were selecting 21. And it was really, I think that, you know, that was probably the most profound experience that I lived through, like gathering and discussing and talking and having this. And I think that, you know, when we discussed the, you know, this one quote of Inka, it's really awful to feel that, you know, we can't say that there are people in my city who can't say publicly their family history. You know, it's just it, you know, you can't just say that. You don't feel secure. You know, you don't feel, and then if you don't feel at home. And that's, and I found myself in a strange position saying, okay, no, but we can do that. Let's try, you know, this way and that way, you know, and that was a compromise. That was a compromise to have it and let have these three dots. And then it was opened in 16, and there was, and it took another, I don't know, 5 years that we put the information plaque, which actually clearly said that the buildings, two synagogues, were blown by units of German army, and the perimeter was kept by the Ukrainian militia, which, so you know, it does matter when you say what you say, just doesn't happen at the same at once. But I think that, you know, precisely being a historian and being a citizen, having this, you know, possibility of conversations and listening, but also sharing my stories, you know, which actually is making this place into a place which probably you want to come back and I want to live. That's maybe an answer.
Storytelling, right?
Mm-hmm. Sofia, thank you very much. You said stories of the people matter. And now I have a question for Marina, because she tells stories of other people, but firstly she listens to other people. What does it mean, Marina, for you to tell stories which are untold till now, to bring these stories and memories to the present time, from the past? And maybe I'm handing over for the into the next part of our discussion. Is it a part of justice for you to bring the people to tell their stories? And yeah, is it justice for you when everybody has a right to tell his or her story?
A big question. I think people have a need to be seen and to be told and to have a place and to have a name. And to have a name in the right place and to belong. And the feature of war and persecution, the first one, main one, is to take people this right to belong and to be. And the violent, the collective violent against groups of people is occurred in the middle of social life, in neighborhood, in relationships, and divided, splitting families, friends, societies, groups. And it's impossible, I think, to get justice without to name it by the name, the persecutors, and also to give voice to the victims, to create new spaces and possibilities to belong again and to be a part of the social place. And it wasn't possible for many, many years in Lviv. And it's now it's possible. In the last 10 years, I think we have a shifting paradigm, new paradigm in the Ukraine at all, in dealing with the past, also with Shoah. Not only, but also with Shoah. And people are ready to get the knowledge. And it's very important personal example of my grandfather who died 2018 and saw a report about new places, new remembers places in Ukraine, also in Lviv. And he said, now I can go, because it's unbelievable to be part of this reconciliation or recognition for my Jewish story, for my personal story, but also for the Jewish story. And I think it's very important and a part of justice and reconciliation to name the crime and to give the place, to create place. It's not simple.
Let's try to go back to the elephants in the room. I mean, it's quite difficult to come to terms with the past. It's not an easy thing, and listening to Marina, listening to Sofia, storytelling might be one way, but to seek for justice might be another way to achieve it. However, there seem to be different ways to achieve some forms of justice, or a form of justice. In our context, Lviv, the Ukraine, the ongoing war of aggression, gross human rights violation, I would suggest there are theoretically probably at least two ways to consider. One way is the late Nelson Mandela's and Bishop Desmond Tutu's Truth and Reconciliation Commission, the South African example, right? The other way would be the proposed Special International Criminal Tribunal for the Crime of Aggression, the Russian invasion in Ukraine. So the South African example is more about storytelling, elephants in the room, and reconciliation. The tribunal is more about sending people to prison. So Philippe, from your point of view as a lawyer and storyteller too, what is your point, or what is your advice, or what is your suggestion regarding coming to terms, if this is really possible, with the situation, the crimes in the Ukraine?
So, even more important than being a lawyer, I'm a human being, and I come to these issues now without drawing rigid demarcations. I think it's more or less as Marina has says, a community needs to find a way to talk about what happened. And there are lots of different ways of talking about things. Formalized criminal justice in national courts or international courts is actually, I think, just one way of telling a story. And Truth and Reconciliation is another way of telling a story. And literature is yet another way. And I think literature actually plays an incredibly important part in putting forward national narratives. But I want to come back to the last part of the conversation, because one aspect of being introduced to Lviv and confronting my own family past and confronting these stories in modern Ukraine has had an unexpected consequence. It has caused me to ask a lot more questions about the country that I happen to live in for most of the year, the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. And one of the things that I have come to appreciate in a very acute way in the last 10 years, and I'm absolutely convinced it's because of the journey to Lviv, is that I would put almost top of those countries that has never come to terms with its past and the darkness of its past, the United Kingdom. We have just been through this spectacle of a coronation, which many, many people in the United Kingdom refuse to have anything to do with, myself included. And part of the reason for that was that embodies a society that has decided to avert its gaze from its own acts of wrongdoing. It has simply passed in silence on colonialism, on enslavement, and on various other horrors, and told itself, as I was told as a schoolboy, your country is great, period. There's no dark side. And one of the things Sofia and I have talked about a lot, and you'll have picked up, my very great sympathy and respect for what Sofia has done, which is remarkable and remarkably courageous in very difficult circumstances, is it's made me realize I have no right to come to Berlin, of all places, and lecture on how you deal with the past. Here is a country that actually has, in relation to the events of 33 to 45, but also in relation, for example, to the genocide of the Herero in 1904 to 1908, actually sought to engage. Has the United Kingdom done that at all, even partly? No, no. It's in the news right now because all of a sudden we've got all these countries, Jamaica, St. Kitts, declaring right now, actually, I don't know if I want to be part of this system with this guy wearing a funny hat being my king. And the themes that connect here is, I think at the end of the day, it doesn't matter in a formal sense how you engage with the past. It doesn't matter, as a matter of form, what is the means for telling the story in a criminal trial, in a form of truth and reconciliation, in books of nonfiction or books of fiction. I'm thinking of writers like Javier Cercas and his books about the Spanish Civil War, which have probably done more than anything to cause people in Spain to start thinking in different ways about that. The common connection is that a community that is unable to grapple honestly with its own past is a community that at a certain point is going to face fundamental difficulties and fundamental problems because it is essentially constructed on a lie. You've asked about the Special Tribunal for the Crime of Aggression. For me, how you deal with Putin's aggression in Ukraine is not a matter of form. There are a lot of different ways of addressing that issue and getting it out on the table. A special criminal tribunal for the crime of aggression to deal with one of the many crimes that is being committed is one way to tell a story. And what's remarkable for me is that the way in which the Ukrainian leadership, I think in part prompted and propelled by the historical fact that one of its major cities happens to be the place of origin of crimes against humanity and genocide and of modern international criminal law, has grasped this and wants to tell us a story about aggression and criminality. But let's talk about another elephant in the room. I mean, 20 years ago, we had another war, which to my mind was as unlawful as this war. And that was the war against Iraq. It was manifestly illegal. The deputy legal advisor at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs resigned and characterized the war as a crime of aggression. But what happened to the United Kingdom and the United States? Nothing. Did anyone talk about creating a special criminal tribunal? Did anyone exclude, as Russian museum directors are now excluded from informal associations of museum directors, the British and the American directors? So there is a problem here, which is that we live in a world of total double standards and total hypocrisy. Where is the special criminal tribunal for Syria? Where's the special criminal tribunal for Georgia? Where's the special criminal tribunal for Kosovo? They don't exist. So as Sophia particularly knows, I am four square behind Ukraine. But the reason the telling of that particular story of justice enters the quicksands of complexity is precisely that we have been so uneven in applying the language of justice and the tales of justice and the tales of wrongdoing. And in the West, particularly for Britain and the United States, we are, as we would say in London, hoist by our own petard. We are confronted with the reality of our own acts of wrongdoing, which we have never confronted. And by having failed to confront them honestly, we have disabled ourselves from addressing this terrible war and this terrible conflict as effectively as we might. But the bottom line is that has happened because we've declined to be honest about what has happened. And so the means to be honest, one can be flexible about. The crucial question is to allow those stories to be told and not to have them shut down.
Quicksands of complexity. Quicksands of complexity, it's something which people would like to know more, probably. And I would like to leave the question of the United Kingdom, which is also dear to me, but I do have similar doubts about that too.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, I mean, precisely.
As soon as one talks about the thing one's not allowed to talk about in the United Kingdom, you know, we celebrate Britain having ended slavery, but who participated in it for hundreds of years? Most of the people, I would say, who attended that event at Westminster Abbey over the weekend, people don't realize this, are beneficiaries of compensation paid by the British state, not to the victims of enslavement, but to the people who owned slaves and who were paid compensation for the loss of their enslaved people. Mm. And almost unbelievably, it is only 4 years ago that a debt which was so huge that it finally got paid off 4 years ago to compensate the slave owners for what happened. So we can't quite completely get away from...
No, we can't, but we shall return to the Ukraine nevertheless. And let's leave the United Kingdom on the side for tonight. I mean, you mentioned crime of aggression. I had a big debate with Sofia about crime of aggression. And I know you're a great supporter to make a case for crime of aggression rather than crimes against humanity or genocide. You think that's something which is kind of interesting in the case of the Ukraine. Could you explore a bit on that?
I mean, I wouldn't say that I would rather see that justice can really come in mm-hmm. different shapes and different forms, and try not to see them hierarchically, because I think that it's really for society now experiencing this terrible war, and you know, it's important to think that there are really many ways of getting justice. Mm-hmm. At the same time, I was rather thinking that it's a kind of, you know, there's a sense of irony there. Because when we were speaking about Lviv as a center of international law, which came with the very much also with the book Philip wrote, there were two crimes in this book, but there was not the third crime. I mean, the story of the book is also around Nuremberg. And it's also quite interesting how the story of Nuremberg is so Western. It's how incomplete it is, because the crime of aggression is a concept which was which came and was conceived by a Soviet lawyer of Jewish origin, not from Lviv. And it's also something that I think just makes us think in, or can push us think, I mean, how do we create these landscapes or of knowledge? So how certain concepts get into the, you know, the first pages and into the book, and how certain stories don't. You know, how, you know, crime of aggression was not in your book. It actually now probably will be in your life, because you're engaged in a contemporary discussion and what is happening with the tribunal mm-hmm. as a crime of aggression. And I think in a certain way, it's also, you know, that that Russian Federation can be, the leadership of Russian Federation can be tried by the concept which was produced in Eastern Europe. You know, there is a conceptual journey and a meeting place at the very end. But it's, you know, the future mm-hmm. is open, and I think that there are definitely more than one crime and more than one tribunal and more than tribunals which are waiting for us.
Kateryna.
Yeah, I wanted to add my last final question to all of you. And you were talking about a lot of dealing with the past and honestly dealing with the past, with the darkness. But now the Ukrainians like experience this darkness. And we were talking a lot about these experiences and about the past, which are somehow these two layers of the history and the reality meets in Ukraine now. And maybe my last question would be the following. What do you see? Do you see some gaps, some voids in the concept of justice for this special case in Ukraine, for a very complex history in Ukraine, like in other places, but in the country which is now experiencing this war? Philippe, would you maybe, would you start? Marina?
I think Philippe Sands will talk about it, about the gaps and possibilities. For me, it's important to say the violence doesn't end with the end of the war, end of the conflict, because the war has many reasons. The war hasn't one reason, but has many reasons about sharing history, Soviet repression, Vorurteile,
prejudice,
and so on. So it's not only the war now, it's about a long history of tension, and from the Russian side, from the imperial side, towards Ukraine. So it will be necessary to reflect and also to name this reason, because this is the reason, it's not objective reason for this war. And I think the legal recognition is the basis, it's very important. For example, the name of Shoah we get very late. So the concept of genocide, of Lemkin, was very important, but it wasn't enough to name the genocide of Jewish people, for example, or of Roma people. Now we have other concepts to name it very concretely. And the legal recognition is very important. Also, the example of Germany show us we didn't have it. So we have maybe, the Germany has maybe the official recognition 40 years later of the crime. But 30 years we had a war without a Shoah, without a genocide. So it's possible to repossess the war without crime and genocide, and it's not possible to do that now. So now it is a war, but it's also genocide against a group, against people in Ukraine, maybe not the nation, maybe not ethnical, because of all the people in Ukraine faced to this war. But legal recognition is the basis, but not enough, and the transmission of history and safeguarding of public knowledge is the goal. So, and also the connection of the people to this story. Because it's not possible to know, to get knowledge about the history. It's possible. In Germany, it's possible, for example, to get knowledge about the history, but not to be connected with this knowledge, not to be a part of this knowledge, the knowledge of others, not of us. So, you know, it's very important, because otherwise we have history, but the history is not shared with others.
Yeah, Philippe, I would like to add the question, how can we get justice without seeing and dealing with own colonial past? And we are now back to Britain, I'm sorry, Daniel. How can we see here, how can we deal with that without seeing our own colonial past? How we can deal with another colonial legacies and imperial legacies, like Russian war against Ukraine?
I mean, what we're confronting in this conversation, which I think everyone is acutely aware of, is these historical matters have various layers of interconnected complexity. So take one example. Many of you, I'm sure, in the room would have been as horrified as I was seeing the images a few weeks or months ago when the Russian foreign minister turned up in South Africa and was warmly greeted. To understand those images, you've got to go back to the period of apartheid. Mm. You've got to understand that one of the few countries in the world that stood by South Africa, blacks in South Africa, for 40 years, was the Soviet Union. And the ANC has never forgotten that. And so it finds itself in a historically complex situation. I think if you talk to the South African leadership, they won't tell you they support the war in Ukraine or the bombing of Kiev or Kharkiv or of other places. But they'll say to you, in our most difficult time, they supported us. And we can't forget that. I'm not saying that as a justification for the position that is currently being adopted by the government of South Africa. I wish they would take a different position. But you can't suddenly take a snapshot of a moment and dehistoricize it. It's completely connected to a long and complex past. It doesn't justify, but it explains why certain countries in the world are not siding with Russia, but not coming down on Russia like a ton of bricks, as I would hope they would come down with them. And I think to understand, to come back to your question about the place of justice, justice and the sense that some form of justice is possible, because it's imperfect. No one knows where justice has been done completely or where it's done perfectly. It's always imperfect, as it is in a domestic legal order, so it is in the international legal order. But what Ukraine has done in a way that I don't think has been familiar in any other modern conflict is to seize notions of legality and illegality and justice and international justice literally from day one. The day the conflict began in February 2022, something happened. And I have thought a lot about what is it about this conflict that has caused the Ukrainian leadership to, as you know, the David in a sort of David and Goliath type of scenario, to use the language of legality and illegality and justice and injustice to its end. It's done it incredibly successfully around the world. That language has enabled it to get resolutions through the UN General Assembly that have achieved very large numbers. It has enabled it to get the International Criminal Court to move even with an indictment of a serving Russian president. Now, we may think that's a terrific thing, but actually it's a pretty complex thing because there will be a backlash that is produced in relation to that act. It will have consequences in the global south. It will not be universally received as a positive development. And you need to understand also, in my view, that the decision of the prosecutor to indict the president of Russia, not for crimes against humanity, not for genocide, but for war crimes, in relation to something as a parent that obviously is hugely important, but in the global scheme of things, the deportation of several hundred children from Ukraine to Russia would not be top of my pile on the list of horrors that have been perpetrated in the last year and a half. Why has he done it? He's done it, I think, to head off the creation of a special criminal tribunal for the crime of aggression, which would take you straight to the leadership. He is totally opposed to the creation of such a tribunal, and the reason that he's opposed to it is not an issue of principle. It's an issue of turf. It's about not having another institution created that would somehow deflect from what is going on in The Hague at the International Criminal Court. I think it's as simple as that. The point is,
nothing is ever what it seems. Everyone is using the justice game for their own particular ends and purposes. And you need to pay, I think, very close attention to how the justice arguments are being utilized and the purposes and ends to which they are being put. But Ukraine has already achieved a huge amount, and in particular, its embrace of arguments of justice and illegality have strongly legitimated its struggle and delegitimated the Russian struggle. And one of the aspects that I learned that was most interesting was that in the military context, that is particularly significant. I remember listening to a BBC radio program a few months ago where the chairman of defense, the most important military leader in the United Kingdom, went on national radio and explained why he was in favor of a special criminal tribunal for the crime of aggression. Because he said, to win a war, you need three things. You need a strategy, you need hardware, and you need to believe that right is on your side. And the idea of invoking justice actually contributes to the context of the struggle, both on a positive side on the Ukrainian side, but also on a negative side on the Russian side. And so I think justice, just as it does within a family or an individual, plays also at the international level a very significant operative function in many directions, imperfect as it is.
Thank you very much. And my last question goes to Sofia. Sofia, what would be justice for a common citizen of Lviv in this war, after this war?
You know, I don't know. You know, I think this is really, you know, it's a path you walk, and I think that's it's very hard to, you know, say that this is really complete. Mm-hmm. And I think that wars don't end. You know, I do hope that this war will end as of today. But the, you know, the whole ruination and death and, you know, wounded, it will not. It will stay with us forever. You know, this is the toll and the suffering and the memory. And I do think that, you know, for citizens of Lviv, or citizens of Ukraine, it will come in different shapes, and I think that each will be figuring that out. I think that we today talk a lot about international. I think this is a very critical part of having, you know, we do understand that not each case will be tried on international level of tribunals, but the, if the all the forms you can imagine, from, you know, courts in Ukraine, from, you know, to text written, stories told. And I think that this is really a justice in each case, but also something which is transformative. I think that society is at the moment is torn apart by incredibly unjust violence, but it also is, you know, reconstructing and recovering itself, you know. And I think that, that's basically what we are looking for, our life to go. And and to conclude, it's actually not about, because we see here the map of Ukraine and with all these links. And I mean, right now we are in the midst, and we still actually do not know how we will call that war. to be honest, you know, that we are revising chronologies. Has war started in 22 or has it started in 14? And it's also was a reckoning moment because in Ukraine there was this officially not called the war, and there are many reasons for that. But I think that one of them is that there is this there is a fear of war. It's like kind of, you know, society, and because the last war in was terrible, you know. It was not the parade that ended in Kremlin. It was like, six terrible years in what is now Ukraine and what is now Belarus, you know. This is really like the toll of occupation, the toll of, you know, all these battles. You know, this is, you do everything, but you do not do war. You know, you can do all the shenanigans, but you just don't do the war. And that was really something that put like a whole new situation and conversation. And this conversation is really global because this touches everybody. You know, it's actually, can you have a perfect memory politics in Germany and have a trade with Kremlin at the same time? How does that up? You know, how does things up that you know, Philippe were also asking? So it's a huge reckoning possibility. And what we will make of that, whether in the city of Lviv or in the country of Ukraine or on all continents of the planet we inhabit, it's really up to us and everybody involved.
Thank you, Sofia. It's up to us. It's a very good bridge to maybe open the floor. We seem to have ended up with much more questions than 90 minutes ago. I'm not sorry for that. I think that's a very good sign. And now over to you. We are a bit running out of time, so maybe we are collecting questions. Yes, go ahead, please.
Thanks very much for this really fascinating discussion. I suppose you sort of mentioned that you, Philippe in particular, you didn't want to lecture people on how to deal with their past. But it also seems to me that given that this panel works on the history of Ukraine and particularly how Ukraine deals with that history and views that history, I'd be really interested to get your thoughts, all three of you, I suppose, on the rewriting of kind of Ukraine's popular historical narrative, especially since the beginning of this war, and the increasing, apparently increasing sort of acceptance of figures like Stepan Bandera and Roman Shostakovich, people like this. And it seems to me that, you know, in the Jewish Museum in Berlin with Ukrainians and people who know Ukraine very well on the stage, this is as good an opportunity as ever to seek to at least get some views on this question. Thank you.
Let me have first a second question. Yes, there's one over there.
My question is a Jewish person too? Jewish people on stage, because we're hosted by the Jewish Museum, and it seems to me since the start of the Ukraine war that there has been a very complex Jewish reaction to the war. On the one hand, because especially the conservative Jewish faction with roots in Ukraine still feels the memory of old wounds, but also because the war seems to have a Jewish face through the person of Vladimir Zelensky. And so because at the same time the conflict between Israelis and Palestinians is being at least narratively negotiated in the West, how would you say these two conflicts with Jewish faces inform each other or at least narratively engage with each other?
Okay, one last question. So first we had Bandera, now the Jewish questions, faces, and here the young man has another question.
Sofia, you mentioned the importance of showing solidarity with displaced people from Ukraine. Marina, you mentioned naming justice. And Philippe, you said you were a human being, as well as the importance of historical reconciliation. I live here in Berlin. I also spent some time in Warsaw after Russia's invasion of Ukraine. And what I saw was signs of solidarity with displaced people I'd never seen before. Which lessons can be learned in Europe and Germany's approach to showing solidarity and justice with displaced people from other parts of the world? I'd also extend that to the UK. but we don't want to speak about that anymore.
Okay, who wants to go first? But let's try to be short. Philippe? Okay. And then Sofia?
I mean, you know, the Bandera stuff is horrific, completely horrific. One of the main places in East West Street is the place where my grandfather, you know, where my great-grandmother was originally from, Zhulkiev. And if you go there now, on one of the main buildings, you will see a massive mural honoring and supporting Stepan Bandera. This is one of the real complexities of dealing with the situation. You know, Mr. Putin tells us Ukraine is a Nazi state ruled by a Jewish leader. And, you know, these levels of complexity that Sofia and I, who once 10 years ago spent a day in a field near a small town called Brody, the birthplace of Joseph Roth, in the company of lots of men wearing Waffen-SS uniforms, supporting Otto Wächter and his creation of the Waffen-SS Galicia Division. So, I mean, we can't possibly address these issues in a single day. I remember reading an extraordinary book called Wartime Lies by Begley, which some of you may have come across. Begley, an American lawyer today and a wonderful writer, won't set foot in Ukraine. He lived in Lviv during the war, and he has described to me and to others what he saw as collaboration. But he will go to Poland. So how do you, you know, work out? People reach their own positions. But I think it's much easier for me to speak out about Bandera than it is for you, Sofia. You find yourself in a very complex situation. You live in Lviv, I don't. And I am deeply respectful of the realities of what you face. The Jewish reaction, again, you know, how deep can we go? On the one hand, the Western powers harangue Russia for occupying illegally a part of the territory of Ukraine. And on the other hand, they do nothing in relation to the illegal occupation by Israel of lands that belong to others. So deal with the double standard. It's a total manifest double standard. You cannot reconcile the two positions. I'm facing this issue right now, writing the third book in what is effectively the East-West trilogy after the Ratline, dealing with one of Hans Frank and Otto Wächter's comrades who escaped to Chile and who in 1973 became a close associate of Augusto Pinochet. And guess what? I found it very hard to find certain members of the Jewish community coming out against Pinochet, because it turned out that many members of the Jewish community loved Augusto Pinochet because he brought stability and various other things. The Jewish community is not monolithic. There isn't a Jewish community. There's a multitude of Jewish communities, and as there are for any communities, British, Polish, Ukrainian, Russian, Germans. And I think my reaction to the question would be, it's why, for those of you who've read East West Street, I come down more comfortably, intellectually, but not emotionally, on the concept of crimes against humanity, focusing on the individual, rather than the reification of the group and the concept of genocide. But equally, I understand feelings of group identity, and they are a reality, perhaps biological, perhaps not, that add a different level of complexity. But generally, I shy away from group reactions or group labels, and I'm more comfortable with individual reactions and individual labels. In terms of solidarity, I think it's for each person who wants to show solidarity to find their way. In my case, it is wearing my day hat as an international lawyer, able to provide whatever support I possibly can to Ukraine in its legal arguments and its legal struggles, and I will go to the ends of the world to do that, whatever concerns I may have about double standards and hypocrisies and other things. At the end of the day, what happened in February 2022 was manifestly illegal and outrageous. And it does, as has been said on the panel, affect us all, and it needs the strongest possible legal response.
That's first Marina, then the last word. So maybe Marina and Sofia, you will have the last word.
I'm afraid my English is not enough to discuss the last one, the last question, because it's very deep and important to talk about it, I think maybe also after the end of the discussion. But important is for me to describe maybe the situation 2010 with Janina Hescheles and the book, the new book of the Jewish community in Lviv, and the trying of the community to reach schools and to reach Rada.
And it wasn't possible. It wasn't possible to do that. That 2010 it was closed. So there wasn't willingness to accept the story of Jewish persecution in Lviv, and also to think about Ukrainian collaboration during the war. 2014, the book was in every school in Lviv. It was possible to talk about it. The city has programs, institutes. Your institute has a so important work to tell the story of Lviv, the multilingual and multicultural story. Why I'm telling that? Because Bandera is a problem, maybe, maybe not. It's also the point of perspective on this historical figure. Also for me, it was shock to see the huge Bandera, you know, the new one, very big and dominant in the city. But and it's I know it's a little bit crazy to integrate this narrative now, also because of uncertainty story of Bandera, because many think it's not clear about him and about his influence in persecuting Jewish people during the war. We know we have facts, but we don't know everything historically. It's my my position, my knowledge now. But the second one is also because the neo-Nazi movement in the Ukraine in the last 10 years was very minor. So after the Maidan, it wasn't possible for them to get so many followers like for the Maidan. And Maidan was a very important line also for Jewish people to want to be a part of this story and of this society and to discover to be Ukrainian, to be part of Ukrainian story. Maybe it's not 100%, it's not possible, but it's process and very dynamic process. So I think now it's very important for us also not to get the Russian myth and legend and arguments to give them the basic, you know, what I say.
Okay, Sofia, have the last short word.
You know, I mean, there are many ways to think about Bandera. One of them is, and here I do credit my colleague here, historian Jan Behrens, so that, you know, it's like 19th and 20th century political figure. You know, we do, it doesn't mean that it's good, but it's like, you know, Bismarck gets a statue. You know, Bandera is the part of the European history of late 19th, early 20th century.
Mm.
And that's not the reason to have the monument to begin with. I think that we actually have to rethink, you know, do we have to have monuments to people who start war, you know, beginning with Napoleon, and move on, you know, back to that's a very good question. Also, moment to think, what is hero and who is hero? Who are heroes and what is heroic? So I think that this is the maybe we are in a, you know, going through experience will, you know, help us to reckon with that and think. In Ukraine right now, it's true that, you know, that it's anti, you know, anti-Russian, obviously, you know, and you go to the past, and past is a box, and you pick up different things from that box. And if you think about, you know, clearly anti-Russian political figures that people would relate to, you know, they probably are not the one who are most, you know, that you can tell a lesson. But, you know, Bandera is a part of history, and that's for us to figure out what story we can tell with Bandera. I mean, me personally, it's a story which is very much Polish-Ukrainian. He's a Polish citizen. And he tells the story of minority which actually gets squished in riots. And I think he might, you know, his story might teach us something. It's just not the what we are now, you know, used to put a monument to. And I think that, you know, it's not about like cutting people from history. We've also done that. So this is not the way to go. You know, it's a solidarity. And I think that the biggest challenge, because right now, because in the moment of, you know, life and death, and of the, you know, of extinguishing the fear of, you know, of being destroyed, the solidarity is to going to Ukraine. And there, as you say, different people can do different things. It's quite extraordinary to see the how Polish society reacted, right? You know, and what do you think about how many? How many issues and conversations we didn't have. And this people-to-people creates a whole different space, maybe for the future, to have this conversation, but in a whole different way about, you know, what happened in the first half of the 20th century. To finally, you know, it's for the future, you know, how this solidarity can be directed to Ukraine and help in this moment, but also how through Ukraine it can be a solidarity which goes to so many other people and places, and how we can multiply that.
Thank you, Sofia. Now I would like to bring the official part of this evening to an end, and my thanks go out to our three brilliant panelists. Sharing with us their challenging point of views, their many elephants in the room, and Sofia Dyak, Marina Chernivsky, and Philippe Sands. And my thanks goes also out to you, bearing with us so long. It's already 9 o'clock. Thanks a lot.
I would like to thank our interpreters for the interpreting German, Ukrainian, and English German. To thank the team of the Jewish Museum Berlin, please. And it was a great pleasure to work with you, Daniel. Thank you for commoderating. Thank you very much. And now you are welcome to drink, to eat, and to communicate.